Father, we just come before you in the name of Jesus. We at the Rock Church World Outreach Center, as you know, sir, never come in to hear from a man, never come in to hear from a woman, never come in to hear from the young, the old, the white, the black, the brown. That's just not going to happen in this place. We're smart enough to know that the teacher of the church, sir, is the Holy Spirit. So we welcome Holy Spirit, touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us. Direct us and motivate us to be all that the Father desires us to be, all that the Son paid the price for us to be, and all that the Holy Spirit empowers us to be. And we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor, Lord, as we live our lives out your way and not our way. We thank you, Father, for a mighty move of your Spirit in our hearts and our lives this day and our city. And Father, we thank you for it because we believe this city is going to get saved in the name of Jesus. Now, Lord, bless all the churches in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet that are preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers. They're our sisters. We bless them as we would bless ourselves. We ask you to bless us. We ask you to bless them also. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement with a great big amen. Tonight, I just wanted to share something that was on my heart. When it dropped on my heart, it was just like, without a doubt, this was God. I didn't have to go any further, didn't have to do any more than I just know after 40 years of doing the word of the Lord, being a theologian, finding out what in the world is the voice of the Lord, what isn't the voice of the Lord. And when God spoke to me about tonight's message, it was a message that's just for you. Even though it's strangely going to be taken out of 2 Kings. And here's the time of 2 Kings, which is literally thousands of years ago. An activity takes place that's described in the Bible as horrendous and disgusting. And we'll see it tonight. But did you know that it's in there for a reason? It's not in there to show you how bad God is or how bad people are. It's in there so that you and I can get a hold of a truth in God's words and start living our lives according to what God would have us to live by. Because, you know, when you do things God's way, things just happen that are right, period. The goodness of God is manifest. When we actually say glory to God on highest, we're really saying the manifested goodness of God is displayed to a lost and dying world. And that's the glory of God. It's not illumination. It's not some light fixture going off. It's not some bright expression. It is literally the goodness of God. In fact, the Bible says, Moses said, when the glory of God passed by, it was his goodness that he saw. The goodness of God is displayed when you and I live out the word of the Lord in our homes, our family, children, finance, dreams, vision, destiny, everything in your life that's in the future. If you live it by the word of God, if you learn the word of God, if you live it by the word of God, marriages, raising children, living your life that way, you'll live in peace and joy and happiness and fulfillment. You will be absolutely, without a shadow of a doubt, the one that God's going to bless. God is looking for a people to bless that'll follow him. He doesn't bless people that don't follow him and do things their way. So if you can say much as you want, God, come on, I'm in this, get into my story, get into my desire, get into my pleasure. Instead, we ought to be saying, God, what's your desire? What's your pleasure? What's your story? Let me get into your way, God, not my way. Let it be your will be done, not my will be done. And when you have that kind of an attitude, all of a sudden, everything in life starts to change. Now, the title of the message is Exceptional Times with an Exceptional God. I love to wordplay oftentimes, you know, studying Greek and Hebrew all these years. I see the expressions that are deep and meaningful in the word of the Lord. This is kind of a fun one, the word exception. The word exceptional times with an exceptional God means this. It actually has two meanings involved. The guys just put them up before I got there, so they're a little bit ahead of time. But the two meanings are kind of fun. The word exceptional means obviously some things that are strange and unusual, and we can use that. But the other side of the coin of the word exceptional is the word, if you will, good or wonderful or very special. So here's a word that is either good or bad, also wonderful and kind and great. And it's the same word, exceptional. Exceptional times, which would be, here we are, if you wanted to title this, here we are in bad times with a great God. And that's what that title is referring to. Exceptional times with a, if you will, put the title back up now and leave it up there for a moment. Exceptional times with an exceptional God. We have a hard times in our lives, oftentimes like today and last week and this time of our life in our country where the right is wrong, wrong is right. That's crazy to say. In other words, 25, 30 years ago, the things that are taken commonplace today, that is accepted in our society today, wasn't even discussed. It was a disgusting thing that nobody even talked about 25, 30 years ago in many areas. And now young people are being brought up as that's the norm in their life. Right is wrong, wrong is right. And we find ourselves absolutely in a massive decay in America. And that's all because these are exceptional times, not to the good, but to the bad. But we have an exceptional God that's with us, and that's to the good, that offsets the exceptional bad times. So many times during the week, I will stop and think about our city and think about the people that are in our city. We just offered this entire church facility to our county workers for a free lunch, a time of a vigil where they can come over and we can love on them and feed them. And that's being discussed in the county right now. And if they want to do that, we're open for that. We'll pay for everything as a church because we love them and care for them. You can't stop last week and think about last week without tears coming into your eyes and pain coming into your heart. It was a horrible expression, horrible, violent time of murder and a horrible, chaotic time of confusion. You could feel it in the air no matter where you were as soon as you heard about it. It's a time when you will never forget where you heard about that particular thing. It's like when I was a young man and John F. Kennedy was killed. I know exactly where I was when I was told that John F. Kennedy, the president of the United States, for those of you who don't know, when he was killed, and believe me, there's a lot of people in here who don't know things like that, but he was killed. And I remember exactly that time. Well, I will always remember that exact time when I heard about what happened in the tragedy of San Bernardino. Exceptional times, bad times with an exceptional God, and that's what we need to focus in. Now, a lot of times we don't realize what takes place before our eyes. The big question to a lot of people is, why God? I mean, why would God allow this? Why innocent people? Why does this take place? First of all, you've got to understand about the world. The world, this is not new in history. This is not new that there is injustices throughout the world. What's new is it's down the street from us. And what's new is that when they were brought here with people with blood all over their clothes and we had to take care of them here at our church, that was new to us. But what wasn't new is the tragedy of this society, the failure of this society. And what we need to realize and recognize that there'll always be the Adolf Hitlers that, can you imagine being in a prison for years, starved, tortured, skinny as a rail, and then being told that you were going to be let out, and they're going to wash you clean and let you go, take you into a building, slam the doors behind you, and there you are gassed. And we talk about millions of people being annihilated from the planet at that very moment. Men, women, children, babies, innocent, hadn't done a thing in the world to hurt or harm anybody. What an injustice that millions of people were eliminated in that particular war. Idi Amin comes along. Debbie was preaching in Uganda, where Idi Amin, they were there at the anniversary of this Holocaust that took place, and she was at one place and a church was there, and she went into this church. You couldn't get in the church. Inside the church to this day are bodies that are stacked up, skeletons, men, women, children, from the floor to the very top, where they were cut in pieces with machetes. They didn't have bullets. It was too expensive to use bullets, so they cut people in with machetes. What was it, 100 million? A million people in 10 days, that's what it was. It was a million people died in 10 days. This is not new. Holocaust, tragedies, injustices go way back thousands of years. These exceptionally bad times have got to be overshadowed in your heart, my heart, with exceptionally good times. And that means God, and God's got to be brought back into the picture. When I was a young man studying scripture, a million years ago, I found myself in a place of realizing there was a lot of things in the Bible that were very strange. A lot of deaths, a lot of slaughter, a lot of killing. I mean, a lot of things that were like, oh my goodness, why would that be in there? I thought this was all love, joy, peace. And I found out that God expresses things in Scripture so that we, the people of God, can understand what life is going to be like without Him. Man, listen to this, without Jesus Christ, destroys itself. The very salt of this earth is Jesus Christ. I'm not talking about dead religion. I'm not talking about foolish people who follow foolish gods that are no gods whatsoever. I'm talking about Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who has proven with an empty tomb, and nobody else has ever done that before, and every scripture for thousands of years has supported him. He is the Son of God. Now, let me just say this to you. Where there is a counterfeit, there can never be a counterfeit unless there's a legitimate or a real. It would be impossible for me to counterfeit a $3 bill because there's no such thing. So in order for me to counterfeit something, I'd have to make it after something that is real. And where there are counterfeit gods that the world is following that make these exceptional bad times for humanity, there is also a true and living God. We know him as Jesus. Come on, somebody. So tonight, I want to show you in the scripture by taking you to 2 Kings about an exceptional time in the lives of the people of Samaria. Now, I'm going to use the word Samaria because you don't know what that means, but it's actually the capital of the 10 northern tribes of Israel, or it could have been the capital of Israel. Okay, the word Samaria comes out there. If you'll remember, there's two southern tribes of Israel, and there's 10 northern tribes of Israel. 10 northern tribes of Israel never served God. They never had a good king. They never did anything right. They were always in battle, but God was always helping them all the time. And then the two southern tribes were the ones that were blessings from time to time with God and followed after the things of God. Are we on the same page? In Samaria, there is a tough time taking place. And I want to take you there, if I may, in 2 Kings, the 6th chapter. Will you go there with me? In verse number 24. And let's take a look at it together, because we're talking about exceptional times, listen to this, with an exceptional God. And you live in an exceptional time right now where things are weird, things are strange, things are hard, things don't make sense. You know, things are troubling. You look at the political powers that may be, you're confused. It doesn't look like there's much hope. You look at the economy. You look at the educational systems that are failing all over the world that are not providing. We're looking at countries that are failing and that are acting incorrectly. And you see this whole economy of this world that's failing before us. And that's exactly what's going to happen when men do not serve truth. And truth is found only in Jesus Christ. Come on. So the more they resist Jesus, the more confusion and frustration and exceptional lifestyle is going to be out there. 2 Kings, I want to read to you. First of all, let me explain to you what's taking place. There is a famine in the land. I'm going to explain what that means in a moment. This is a hard time. Remember, this is written for you. So you can pretend to daydream, or you can think about something else, but stop and think about it. God right now is trying to point out to you how to deal with difficult times, how to understand that the time that you're going through right now may not be the worst time that's ahead. And we need to be wise enough to look at Scripture and see what takes place in history about exceptional, horrible times and how there was a living God there that takes care of everything. Listen closely, if you will. The 6th chapter, 2 Kings, verse 24. And it happened after that, that Ben-Hadad, King of Syria. Now this is bad. King of Syria. They're the bad guys. Okay? Gathered all of his armies and they went up and besieged Samaria. Samaria, remember, the capital of Israel at the time. So here we see the bad guys, and they did what? They came up and they besieged Samaria. They put the pressure. Times are tough. Very difficult times. You know, if you and I lived in those times, we would say something like this to each of our neighbors and our families, to ourselves. We'd say, why? What did we do? Deborah was flying back from Israel a couple of months ago as she was ministering in Israel. She came back, sat next to a Jewish guy, young man, and he made this statement. He says, I would only figure out why people hate us so much. He had a troubled time. Why do people hate us so much? And here he makes a statement that the armies have besieged Syria. They hadn't done anything wrong. They hadn't provoked anybody. It was injustice. People's lives are at stake. Pressure. Can you imagine the pressure that's on right now? If we had a military that took us over, we don't have things like that in our country yet. I'm not saying that we ever will. You probably would never experience with it. I just read to you. But the next verse comes up, verse number 25, which is really fascinating. It says this, and there was a great famine in Samaria. Now let's talk just for a moment. The great famine, when God says the word great, how many of you realize it's really great? I mean, it's not a little famine, it's a great famine, but most of you don't even know what the word famine means. Is that okay that we talk just for a moment? I want you to hear me. For those of you who don't know what the word famine means, it means there's a lack of everything that brings food. For an example, it was an agricultural society, so everything stemmed on whether or not there was rain. They hadn't yet harnessed the power of aqueducts and water wells, and they hadn't yet had reservoirs set up or anything like that. They couldn't even transfer until the Roman Empire water from one place to the other place except by a donkey. So it had to rain. And how they fed their fields, by rain, or they took it out of a river with a bucket and they fed each plant at a time, which provided for their family. Now, if they didn't have enough greenery growing, their animals would starve. Their goats, which they loved because they eat anything, and then the sheep ate anything and shouldn't eat anything, and then you find oxen and donkeys and things such as that, but they were not people who ate the donkeys or anything like that. Everything depended literally on whether or not it rained. And when they say great famine, God is saying there's great starvation, there's lack of food, there's lack of water, there's lack of resources, people are hungry, they're not eating at all. You and I haven't even experienced that. If we did experience that, we would be complaining to our families and our neighbors. We would say, oh my goodness, what's going on? Where's God? Why is this happening? What have we done? We haven't done anything wrong at all. And yet we're experiencing this horrific famine that we're in. And he says, and indeed they besieged it until donkeys' heads were sold for 80 shekels of silver. Now, you said, let me just read that to you again. They besieged the city until donkeys' heads were sold for 80 shekels of silver. So you say, what the heck does that mean? That means they were so starving, had so little food, that they took the head of a donkey and they got big bucks for it just so somebody could eat. They were getting 80 shekels of silver for a donkey's head so someone could eat the donkey's head. Now, when you talk about times of exceptional pressure and horrible situation, and not only is God expressing that so we can understand what way we're going through, so that when you are facing something that is weird and strange, you can go through it too, but he also goes on to define, not only was it bad with a donkey's head getting so much money for it, but then he goes on and he expresses this, and he says these words, and 1/4 of a cab. Now, the word cab is an interesting word. It means about a pint. So if you figure a pint, 1/4 of a pint is what he just said, of doves' droppings for 5 shekels of silver. Now, I don't know if you got the fullness of what he just said. I stop, I look at that, I'm thinking, oh my God, they're selling a quarter of a pint of dove doo-doo to eat. I didn't even know you could eat dove doo-doo. My question is, who'd want to eat dove doo-doo? How hungry could you be to eat dove doo-doo? If I invited you over to dinner, I said, Debbie is cooking dove doo-doo tonight. You're going to love every bit of it. How many of you would not show up? I mean, it's like nuts. I mean, what God is trying to say is this is true, but he's trying to make a statement to you. Yeah, hey, we have tragedy in our city. We're faced with an exceptional time of weirdness, uncomfortableness. You know, we're facing situations we can't really put a finger on. We don't know why they happen. You know, this is just nuts. That's what you probably said to yourself last week, at least a couple of times. These are nutty conditions that we live in. But look at this. They're selling a quarter of a pint of dove droppings for 5 shekels of silver. Oh my goodness. It goes on in verse number 26. Now that just shows how deep the famine is. That's what he's trying to point out to us, how miserable the people are. But then he goes on and he shares something more that is one of the most bizarre verses I've ever read in Scripture. Are you ready for it? Because he's trying to make a point that in the midst of a crazy world where the bottom has fallen out, there is a living God. And you may not know how it's going to work. You don't know where it's coming from. You don't know when the rescue is going to take place. You don't know how you're even going to make it. But I'm here to tell you, those that attach themselves to a living God live. Those that do not attach themselves to a living God fail. Now you got to get this, because in verse number 26 it says, then as the king of Israel is passing by on the wall, a woman cried out to him saying, help my Lord, O king. Verse 27, he said, if the Lord does not help you, then can I find help for you from the threshing floor or from the wine press? In other words, can I give you something that I don't have if God can't give you something that he doesn't have? Pretty good answer. But she makes a statement in verse number 28. The king said to her, and the king said to her, what's troubling you? And she answered, this woman said to me, give me your son that I may eat him today, and I will give you my son. So we boiled my son and ate him. And I said to her the next day, give me your son that we may eat him. But she had hidden her son. Wait a minute. We're talking about so hungry, cannibalism is inside of Israel. And they're boiling the children and eating them. You got to be pretty hungry, my friends. You got to look at that situation as saying, oh my goodness, that is so unjust, so cruel, so crazy, so bizarre. This surpasses last week's experience in San Bernardino by a mile. And yet someone is experiencing it. They're in such bad shape, so starving, they're boiling their children and eating them. My goodness, you talk about exceptional problems. That's one. Drop down, if you will, because the king does a bunch in the next bunch of verses, but I want to get some verses for you tonight that are kind of interesting. In chapter number 7, verse number 1, something takes place about that situation. Keep in mind, there's a famine in the land. People are starving to death. They're killing each other over starving to death. There's no food whatsoever. There's injustice upon them and around them. Can you imagine the chaos? Can you imagine the panic? Can you imagine the starvation? Can you imagine people that are so panic-stricken, they're eating dove dung, dung, or whatever it's called, and they're eating the oxen heads, and they're eating their own children. Can you imagine how horrible times must have been, and how fearful it must have been because the city was under besiege? In other words, there's an army just outside ready to pounce on us. Do we live a day? Do we live 2 days? Can somebody help us? Why doesn't some government employee do something? And that's the cry of American society today. It'll never be a government employee. You might as well understand that. As well and as good things as they do, we thank God for them. But the answer is Jesus Christ. And we can yell all we want at the government employees that don't do what they're supposed to do. But the answer is they're just doing what people that don't know Christ does. And this country will never change until the country gets lined up with Jesus. Let me go on. The story continues in the 7th chapter, verse number 1. Then Elijah, the prophet. You remember Elijah's a prophet. Now let's talk about that for a moment. He brings the word of God. When he speaks, it's like God speaking. They didn't have a Bible on their lap like you have that you can look into the word of God. So if you wanted to know what God's word was tomorrow, you can look into the word of God and find out the heartbeat, character, nature, and attributes of God by looking at the Bible. They didn't have that. What they had are prophets coming through. One was Elijah. This happens to be Elisha, a man of God, a great miracle, signs and wonders. And when he spoke for God, by the way, God backed what he said because he said what God told him to say. And Elisha said, "Hear the word of the Lord." You know, some people hear the word of the Lord, some people don't. Just like tonight, you're looking at me. I've got black pants, black shoes, black shirt on. You're looking at the old man's 70-year-old face, and you're saying something to yourself. I don't know if I will listen to him or not listen to him. I don't know if I like his personality, don't like his personality. I don't like this about him or that about him. Or I do like that or I do like that. This one, can I tell you something? We're here not to hear from a man. We're here to hear from the Lord. And when you come into the house of God, it may be a man that's speaking, but he better speak according to the Bible, or we're not listening to him at all. Are you following me? And it's not here to listen to anything except what the Bible says, what God says. So when someone speaks a word of the Lord, it better be lined up and matted up with the word of God, the Bible. And a lot of times people come in and don't believe it's the word because they judge the man. So here he is speaking to Samaria, the whole entire leadership. You would think that everybody would say, "Oh my goodness, did you hear what he just said? I guess what he says is going to come to pass because God said it." And you know he's got a great track record. Did you know that there's no indication whatsoever that the people even believed what this prophet of God had to say? In other words, he's not any different than an American San Bernardino today. Sorry. Not any different whatsoever. Some people will listen as if God is speaking to them, and they will adhere to it and do it and get totally blessed. Other people will let it run off their back like water off a duck's back and never go anywhere because they just don't believe it. It was God speaking to them. But I'm using the Bible tonight. Is anybody listening? And you ought to be listening because we're talking about these exceptional times that you're in right now and that you're going to be facing in the future. It's not going to get any better. But so you better listen. And God put this in here for us to understand. So here's Elijah speaking the word of the Lord. And Elijah says this, "Tomorrow about this time, a seah of fine flour shall be sold for a shekel." In other words, not a ton of money, just a little bit. You see the word seah right there? The word seah means it's like 6 gallons, if you will, of flour, fine flour. Didn't just say flour, but fine flour. That means it's refined, ready to use. 6 gallons for like a nickel. Remember, they're starving to death. See, sometimes what we do is we're in problems today. We don't realize how fast God can get us out of the problem. Is anybody listening? We lose hope because of the situation around us. It doesn't make sense. We lose hope because it doesn't make sense. We can't figure out how in the world it could possibly happen. But I'm here to tell you something. When you got an extreme situation, you can have an extreme God. And if the situation is bad, God could deliver you in one day. And the prophet comes along and he says, tomorrow about this time, in other words, within 24 hours, that fine flour that you all bust your gourd for, you can buy for a nickel. And then he comes along and he says, and 2 shekels of barley for a shekel at the gate of Samaria. In other words, it won't just be out there. So right there at the gate, we won't have to go looking for it. It'll be right at the gate. You can, for 2 shekels, that's like a quarter, you can buy 12 gallons of barley. Remember, these people have been eating ox heads. They've been eating dove doo-doo. Some have been eating their kids. They're starving to death. And here comes this prophet and says, tomorrow everything's going to change. Which brings us to verse number 2, which is an interesting verse. Are you there with me? In verse number 2, I'm not there. I'm turning my page. Verse number 2, so the officer of those whose hand of the Lord leaned answered the man of God and said. Now, wait a minute. Here's this guy who speaks to the king of Samaria, a guy. The king leans on his advice because he's so smart and he's so cool. Surely whatever he says, the king will hear, and won't we be delivered by the king? He comes along and he makes this statement. He says, look, if the Lord would open up the windows of heaven, could this thing even be? In other words, he's mocking the man of God. Mocks the man of God. And what he really is saying there is, there's no way, Jose, that you're going to get that kind of food here tomorrow and buy it at that price at the gate of Samaria. It ain't going to happen, even if God opened up the windows of heaven and poured it out on us. But I thought last part of that verse, it says this, and he said, in fact, this is the prophet speaking to the leadership, and he watched this. He says, in fact, you shall see it with your eyes, but you'll not eat of it. And oftentimes, we don't really take serious what the Word of God has to say. And we will see it with our eyes, but we will not partake. Even if we see it, we won't partake, because guess what, my friends? Somewhere along the line, there was a mocking in the heart. There was a criticism in the heart. There was a, I'm not so sure in the heart. There was a judgment in the heart. You and I got to be something. If the Bible says it, we need to believe it. Yes, we're in exceptional, extreme times right now. We're under a pressure. There's things around us that we've never experienced before. Man, it's at our back door. But I'm here to tell you, with a being at our back door, Jesus is at our front door. Come on, somebody. And so this is an attitude. So he makes a statement. He says, man, you're going to see it, but you won't get it. And he goes on to say these words. Let's take a look at them together. In verse number 3. And there now the story starts to change for you and I. And it's a really wild story from this point on. It's pretty good so far, don't you agree?
Yes.
Let's try this side. It's pretty good so far, don't you agree?
Yes.
Okay, now the story starts to change and it even gets better. Notice this in verse number 3. It says, now there were 4 leprous men. When I read that, it's like, wait a minute. What has leprous men got to do with it? For those of you who don't know what leprosy is, let's talk just for a moment. We don't have that problem nowadays. And it's a simple cure to leprosy. Thank God that it is, that science has found. But in those days, they didn't have a scientific correction of leprosy. If you got leprosy, you died. And you died in an unusual way. You rotted away. Your flesh was gone. And there was no hope for you whatsoever. There was no social life. There was nothing for you. You lost your fingertips, then you lost your fingers, then you lost your hands. You lost part of your arms, then your feet and your toes were gone. And all of a sudden, your facial expressions, your nose would fall off, your eyes would fall off. The flesh was absolutely being removed. And these 4 lepers are saying something to each other. Notice what it says. They're sitting at the entrance of the gate. Oh, what gate? The gate of Samaria. And they said to one another, why are we sitting here until we die? Because, you know, there's nothing else that they had. Sometimes I find myself equating Christianity, or at least Christians, with these 4 lepers. There's a lot of things in common. I hate to use that as an example of commonality, but let's just talk just for a moment. For an example, with Christianity, there is a loss of flesh. In Christianity, there's a rejection, as these lepers were, by the people. In Christianity, there's no hope but God. There's no peace but God. Your whole reliance has got to be on God. Your future is about God. And the only place that means anything is you're going to heaven, just like these lepers. And they make this statement, which is a statement that a lot of Christians ought to be asking themselves. Why are we sitting here until we die? Let's at least do something. I've told Deborah a million times in my life, I'd much rather lose everything and try for God than to have a ton of safe stuff and never try doing anything. It's just the way I'm made. It's just the way it is. Doesn't matter how old I am, I just get more crabby about it. I just want to do more. Now here we find these lepers that are sitting at the entrance of the gate. Verse 4. If we say, remember there's a famine in the land. Remember there's starvation going on. Remember the people are eating dove dung. There are people out there that are starving, killing their babies. That's still going on. This is a side story to talk about four lepers and what they do about that side story. Watch this. Verse number 4. If we say we will enter into the city, the famine is in the city and we shall die there. And if we sit here, we shall die also. Now therefore come and let us surrender to the army of the Syrians. If they keep us alive, then we'll live. If they kill us, we shall only die. And that's really the attitude of everything. Let me say this to you, my friends. No one can ever take heaven away from you. No matter what they do to us. This is the attitude we all ought to have. The attitude is, you know what? The worst you can do to me is the very best thing that'll ever happen to me. Because God takes all things and makes them great. Are you following me? It's an amazing thought. So they arose, verse number 5, at twilight to go to the camp of the Syrians. And when they came to the outskirts of the Syrian camp, to their surprise, no one was there. Let me say it again. This is a professional army besieged the capital of Israel, professional warriors, and they're all gone. I'm here to tell you something. When you think there's no way, there's a God who knows the way. And we forget that all the time. We only evaluate from what we think and what we see and what we're feeling. He says these words. He says this, verse number 6. Listen to me. When God's on your side, do what he wants to do. Yes. Amen. You know, I don't care what kind of a crappy situation you're in right now. Maybe you're in your own personal famine. I'm here to tell you something. You might be in your own personal famine, but God's great. You might be in your own personal famine, but I'm here to tell you something about God. God can do great, mighty, marvelous, and wonderful things. And the Lord caused the army of Syrians to hear the noise of chariots and the noise of horses and the noise of a great army. So they said one to another, next part of that verse, please. Look, the king of Israel, he's hired against us. These are mercenaries. He thought he hired a bunch of mercenaries. The king of the Hittites and the king of the Egyptians attack us. Oh no, oh no, oh no. Verse number 8 or 7. Therefore they rose and they fled at twilight, left the camp intact, their tents, their horses, their donkeys, and they fled for their lives. Verse number 8. And when the lepers came into the outskirts of the camp, they went into one of the tents, they ate, they drank, they carried off the silver and the gold and the clothing, and they went and hid themselves. And when they came back, and they entered another tent and carried some from there also and went and hid it. Verse number 9, just for fun. Then they said one to another, we are not doing right. This day is a day of good news. And we remain silent, if we wait until morning light, some punishment will come upon us. So they go down and they tell the king. The king doesn't believe it. Even though the prophet said something, they start to debate it back and forth. I won't take you to all of that. I mean, guy, come on, king. People are eating each other. Come on, king. You got to be kidding me. They're eating bird poop. Come on, king. They're whatever it is. And a prophet came and told you. Now these guys come in with no agenda whatsoever to tell you that there's nobody there. And you can take it. They start arguing among each other. He finally sends some people down. Let's pick it up, if you will, in verse number 15. 14. Therefore, they took chariots and horses, and the king sent them in the direction of Syrian army, saying, go and see. And when they went after them to Jordan, and indeed all of the road was filled with garments and weapons, and the Syrians had thrown away in their haste. So the messengers returned and told the king. And then the people went down and they plundered the tents and the Syrians. Verse number 16. And so a seelah of flour was sold for a shekel, and the two seelahs of barley for a shekel, according to the word of the Lord, according to the word of the Lord. In your darkest times, there's a God that wants to help you and lift you out. You don't have to know how you're going to get out. You just know that there's a God that will open the door that no man can open and close the door that no man can close. We forget that all the time. When you don't know how your bills are going to make it, you're looking at your checking account, you're looking at borrowing money from your aunt, you're looking at the post box, when is it coming in? You're looking at some way to raise the money. You need to look at God. God, what would you have me to do? He's the one that makes a way where there is no way. When you don't know how you're going to make it, God knows how you're going to make it. And then they come and they feed, and it's everything that the word of God says. And if I read you the rest of the verses, it would go on to say this and repeat that the very man that doubted whether it could be done or true was trampled to death by the people. He saw the truth, wasn't allowed to partake, and he died. Now here's the purpose, the point. When we know it's God's ways and we question God, doubt him, we will end up dying like everybody else. Is that not what happened to the children of Israel? They came out of Egypt, miracle after miracle after miracle, died off in the wilderness because they grumbled all the time against God. And here you've seen the very spiritual leader, the very physical, political leader of the king being trampled to death. Put that verse up if you can, the next verse, if you will. And just put it up. And it says, an appointed officer that was had, he that leaned in charge of the gate. Watch this verse B, please. He says, but the people trampled him at the gate and he died. Just as the man of God had said, who spoke when the king came down to him. Yeah, these are exceptional times that you live in. They're not so hard that there isn't somebody with a machete cutting a million people up in 100 days. They're not so hard that 6 million people walked into the gas chambers in your lifetime. They're not so hard about all the children that never got past the age of 3 or 4 worldwide. They're not so hard, my friends, let me tell you something, that more than half of the population of this planet went to bed tonight with less than a bowl of rice in their stomach. Less than a bowl of rice in their stomach. Yeah, we're experiencing tough times. There's no doubt about it. Nothing worse than human loss. Nothing worse than families without leaders or moms or dads. I hurt for you. But I want you to know you're not alone in this world. We've had thousands of years of this kind of injustice take place. And I love the American church. You've got to understand the church, whether it be in China, America, or Europe, it's like an old Persian rug. The more you step on it, the more valuable it becomes. And I want you to know something, my friends. We don't back off. We're a church. We don't give up. We don't quit. No matter how bad things get, and they can get really bad, that God wrote it that way just so you would understand that times are a whole lot tougher than what we're experiencing. But we got a living God who's great, mighty, and marvelous. And we get to walk out of here tonight praising His name. Some of you in here tonight haven't made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life. You're not going to make it if you don't. I need you to question yourself. I need you to ask. I don't need you to doubt me. And I don't need you to get up and walk out right now. Everybody stay seated. You can do that. You don't need to be rude and walk out. I'm too old to let you walk out. And I don't give a flip what you think of me at my age, because I know what you think of me. So I'm going to be tough with you because I'm in San Bernardino and I can be tough. So don't get up anymore. I'm going to come down there and beat you up myself. Sit down and stay down. Let's talk. Your eternal soul is at stake. I'm going to ask you a question. And I want you to answer the question in your heart, because God says that you should examine yourself from time to time to make sure that you're right with Jesus. I'm going to ask you a question. This will tell you where you're at with God. You answer the question in your heart. Nobody will know but you and God. Here's the question. If you were to walk out of here tonight, head towards your car, bang, your heart stops and you die. Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? I don't give me that you don't believe in hell stuff. God believes in hell, because you don't believe in hell doesn't make hell go away. It's like you saying, I don't believe in Mack trucks. Go stand out in the freeway. One's going to run you over any minute. It won't make it disappear. It doesn't make it go away because you don't believe in it. I answer the question, are you going to heaven or are you going to hell if you died in the next few minutes? Now, let's make sure you're going to heaven. Is that okay? Someone might say, well, Pastor Jim, you don't understand. I think I'm going to heaven. Can I tell you something that you don't understand? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say you can think your way into heaven? He's not looking for positive thinkers. That won't get you to heaven. Nope, not going to make it. Somebody needs to tell you. You might say to yourself, well, I think I'm going to heaven because I have a lot of hope on the inside of me. I hope I'll make it. I hope. Guess what? Nowhere in the Bible does it say because you're a big hoper, you get to go to heaven. You're not going to make it. Some of you might say to yourself, well, wait a minute, Pastor Jim, you don't understand. I'm going to go to heaven because I'm really good, man. I'm a good person. I would never do that. I would never hurt anybody. I'm always good. Guess what? Nowhere in the Bible says you get to go to heaven because you're good. Did you know that? But most American church Christians that call themselves Christians think they're going to heaven because they're good? You can't get to heaven. It's not in the Bible that says so. Jesus tells us exactly how to get to heaven. First of all, He's a beaten, bloody mess for you and I. Aren't you amazed that a God would love us enough not to have somebody else's life extracted, but He lays His own life down? So that's real love for us. God Himself dies for us so that we can live. A beaten, bloody mess, nailed to the cross. Are you following me? And He does that so not just Christians can get saved, the whole world can accept Jesus. He died for the whole world, the Bible says. So anybody can come to Jesus and get right and go to heaven, but you got to do it His way. He said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man goes to the Father except by me. In other words, you can't get to heaven your way. You can't get to heaven your way or your way. You can't get to heaven my way or some well-meaning church committee's way. You have to get to heaven His way. Oh, what a shock. His way. And He tells us exactly how to get to heaven in the scripture. He says this in John 3rd chapter, you must be born again. You say, wait a minute, man, I heard about born again people. They're crazy, radical, fanatical idiots. Yes, Hollywood has portrayed born again people that way, but that's not Hollywood. Hollywood has no idea or clue about anything. And if Jesus said it, He's not talking about that kind of craziness. Born again means something. Here's what it means from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible. Let me tell you what it means. It means you've given God all of your heart. It means you've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Bottom line, all or nothing. Forgive us in American churches for watering that down, but that's the way it is. It's all or nothing, and I'll prove it to you. Last book in the Bible, the book of Revelation, Jesus said he's coming again, and you know he is. Now watch this, watch this, watch this, watch this, all or nothing. He says these words, when I come again, I better find you hot or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Oh my goodness. If I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Jesus said those words. What's lukewarm? Let me define it for you. A little in, little out, little up, little down, token prayer, occasional church attendance. You're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Oh my goodness, how many people do we know that are that way? You're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. God is just something in your life like your car or anything else. He's just something in your life. And that's lukewarm, my friend, and you're not gonna make it. In order for you to get right with God, you're going to have to do something. You're going to have to give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. He won't steal it from you. He's not a thief. He's not a conniver to talk you into it or a manipulator to make you do it. Don't you know that God could hit you in the head with a 2x4 right now at this very moment, enough times to make you say, I surrender, I'll give my heart and life to Jesus. Doesn't want that. It made you a free will choice, that you free will make the choice to go to heaven or to go to hell. It's your call. Nobody in their right mind wants to go to hell, but guess what? A lot of people, just like in the time of that prophet, won't listen. And God wants you to know tonight is your night of salvation, to give him all of your heart, give him all of your life, be born again, headed for heaven, and deny your presence in hell. But in order to do something, you're gonna have to give it to him. Surrender to him all of your heart, surrender to him all of your life. So here we are, we're in the safe, friendly place. We've laughed, we've clapped, we've sung songs. It's been a great night. I'm ready to let you go in just a moment or two. But guess what? There's those of you that need to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life, because guess what? That's how you get born again. And that's the way it works. It's that simple. You can't get there because your mom and dad told you were a Christian. Can't get there because you were baptized or christened as a baby. Nowhere is that in the Bible. You're not going to make it if you think that's going to get you to heaven. It's now you're an adult. Now you make the call. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? And today, here we are in this safe, friendly place, and it's now time for you to give God all of your heart, all of your life. You say, Pastor, how do I do it? How do I do this? Well, let's do it God's way. Let's don't do it my way or your way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. In a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go like this. One, two, three, and I'll pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear that sound, bang! Your hand goes up. I'll see your hand go up. You can put it right back down. What you're saying by the raising of your hand is I don't want Jesus in my head like most Americans, because we all know who Jesus is. We all celebrate Christmas. We all celebrate Easter. That does not make us a Christian. Even the devil knows who Jesus is. So it's not about having Jesus in your head. It's about what you've done with your heart. Have you given him all of your heart, given him all of your life? Guess what? That's when you become born again, giving him all of your heart, giving him all of your life. In a moment, I'll pop my hands together. You get your hand up, put it right back down. You say, wait a minute, Pastor, hold on, stop. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. People I came with will see me. The people around me will see me. Forget it, man, I'll be embarrassed. Come on. Yep, you might be embarrassed for a moment. But isn't it better to be embarrassed in a safe place like this for a moment than to be in hell forever and ever and ever and ever, because you care more about what people think instead of what God says and what he sees? Come on, tonight is your night of salvation. All you have to do is make an expression. He said, if you confess me before men, I'm a man, I'll see it. By putting your hand up and then putting it right back down. Simple as that. You're making a statement. I don't want to go to hell, I want to go to heaven. Pray for me, Pastor, and we'll pray together. God's going to bring you home. Tonight is your night of salvation. This is your time to be with God, and you're going to have to do it. Nobody can make you put your hand up. That's the crazy thing about it. Nobody can make you do this. It doesn't work unless it comes from your heart. That's the difference with Christianity. It's got to come from the heart. Tonight, here you are in this safe, friendly place. Let's get right with God. Who should raise your hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your life, you know who you are. I'm speaking to you. If you're one of those people that are not sure, then make sure. I'm speaking to you. If you're in this place and you've never given him all of your heart, you know who you are. Come on. I'm speaking to you. All you have to do in a moment is get your hand up, make the statement, and let's go for God. I don't care what anybody says. You want God to see you do that. Tonight is your night of salvation. I'm counting to three. Here it is. I've done my job. I love you. You are great listening to the Word of God, but don't miss out on this very important moment. Tonight is your night of salvation. Are you ready? Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one. Thank you. There's two. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? Real quick. There's two wise people. Anybody else? I just know there's more than two. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? You're thinking about putting your hand up? Get it up. You ought to. You're the one that I'm talking to right now. Anybody else? There's, thank you. I see that. You can put that hand down. I already counted you. God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Real quick. Two wise people? Two wise people? Three wise people. God bless you. Now you're starting to come out. See, I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Why wouldn't you want to get right with God? Why wouldn't you want to be born again? Why wouldn't you want to go to heaven? Come on, if you haven't already done this, you need to do this. There's three wise people. I'm going to do one more pass over this audience, and that's it. I've done my job. Anybody else that needs to raise their hand? Anybody else that needs to raise their hand? There's three wise people. Anybody else that needs to raise their hand? Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, praise God for three wise people. Come on, give the Lord a great big praise. You do that? Hey, listen, all three of you that raised your hands, thank God for you raising your hands. I think it's wonderful. Could you do me a favor? I want you to get out of your seat in a moment. We're all going to stand where nobody's going to leave. We're all going to stand. And all three of you that raised your hand, and anybody that should have raised your hand, there's at least five more of you that should have raised your hand, but you didn't raise your hand. It's not too late. You can get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. Get a friend if you need to. Get in the aisle. Meet me right here in front. Is that okay? All five of you, especially all three of you that raised your hands, you get your stuff and bring a friend if you need to. Come on up here right now. Let's welcome them as they come, because you don't get saved raising your hand. Get up here and let's pray. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on home. Give them a hand as they come. Come on, you come too. Come on, come on, come on. Well, thank God you guys have come. This is my friend, Pastor Joel. Look to your left. He's going to pray with you. Only takes a few moments. Is that okay? People came with a wait for you. Give you some free stuff about what to do next. Is that okay? And then let you go home. Thanks so much for coming. You're going to love this. This is the most important day of your life. You receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, born again, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Yay! This is a good thing, not a bad thing. So put a smile on your face. Is that okay? It only takes a few moments. Follow Pastor Joel right over there. Is that okay? Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.